This meeting is now called to order. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have a roll call, please?
Here.
Mr. Prince?
Here.
Ms. Witchy?
Here.
Mr. Person? Mr. McIrvin?
Here.
Ms. Perez?
Here.
Mr. Bavoni?
Here.
Roll call, Mr. Mayor, one absent.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. Corman.
Move the absent council member be excused.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Corman, second by Mr. Bavoni, that council member Person be excused. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Well, we have a special presentation. We're very thankful to have two members from Sound Transit here to give us a little update on what the Sound Transit 3 draft plan is that's going before the voters in November.
I don't know if I turned it on or turned it off.
They're on.
Good evening, Mayor Law and council members. My name is Val Beatty. I'm a senior transportation planner at Sound Transit, and with me is Andrea Tull, who's also a senior transportation planner at Sound Transit. And we're here to give you a quick overview of the draft ST3 plan, which is out for review, for public review this month. Just really quickly, Sound Transit is a 3-county district, serving from Everett in the north to Tacoma in the south and east as far as the Sammamish Plateau, with light rail, Sounder commuter rail, and regional express bus services. This slide illustrates the expansion that has been underway with Sound Transit's Link light rail service. This reflects projects that originated in Sound Move and ST2. We just recently opened our Link Light Rail station at the University of Washington and Capitol Hill, and later this year we'll be opening the Link Light Rail station at one stop beyond the airport at Angle Lake. We will continue the expansion. All of the projects shown here are in final design and about to start construction for the East Link line, opening in Redmond, the Redmond Technology Center in 2023, Kent Des Moines Station in 2023, and Linwood Station in the north in 2023. This just recaps the ST2 projects that are underway. As approved by the voters in the ST2 plan. The one thing I didn't mention in the previous slide, the project on here, Tacoma Link Extension, also expands in 2022, as well as Northgate Link Extension in 2021. Sound Transit is experiencing growth in ridership since we started service in 1999 with Regional Express Bus. We continue to see a growth in ridership every year, and we'll continue to do so as the system expands. So why are we here tonight? Well, if you haven't noticed, the region is growing. More people are attracted to the Central Puget Sound region and calling it home. We're expecting to grow by 1 million people by 2040. So Sound Transit has been looking at this growth and trying to address it with our different services. Our board updated our long-range plan in 2014. That's the plan that's similar to a city's comprehensive plan. So it's a plan, it's a vision for what the transit system will be in the future. It's unconstrained by budget and by year, and that sets the groundwork for all of the system plans, such as Sound Move and ST2, and now ST3, that are based in that long-range plan. We also received the authority from the legislature to move forward with a third phase of Sound Transit's system expansion. And so since 2014, we've actually been moving towards putting together a draft system plan that we're calling ST3. And the plan is to have the board adopt that system plan in June so that it can be placed on the ballot this November. So what we're doing in ST3 is a bold investment in the transit infrastructure. Transit will benefit the quality of life, the economy, and the environment. And increased transportation capacity in the busiest corridors is part of the ST3 plan. This plan will be a series of projects that will be delivered steadily over the 25-year lifetime of the ST3 plan. And at the end of that plan, we'll have a regional 112-mile light rail system with fast, frequent, and reliable service serving more riders and communities, up to 525,000 daily riders by 2040. Andrea is going to talk a little bit about what is in the plan for Renton and the subarea, the east subarea, in the ST3 plan.
Thanks, Val. So if you look at the map, you can see the orange line that goes from Bothell. It actually goes further to Linwood, and it goes south through Kirkland to Bellevue to Renton, and then it continues on to the west to the Tukwila International Boulevard Light Rail Station and to Berrien. And that would provide 10-minute headway service, so 10 minutes during the peak periods and 15 minutes during the off-peak periods. And additional parking is planned at the Kingsgate Park and Ride, which is kind of northern Kirkland, and then a parking garage with 700 stalls and a transit center in the South Renton area to improve access to this service. In addition to the 405 service, there would be an extension of light rail from the Overlake area into downtown Redmond and light rail from Bellevue to Issaquah. And then in addition to that, there's an environmental study with a gray dashed line that would look at connecting Bellevue, Kirkland, and Bothell. Okay, next slide. So these are some highlights of the whole plan. As Val mentioned, with build out, the system would be 112 miles long. It would be north to Everett, south to Tacoma, east to Redmond, and west to Ballard and West Seattle. It would extend Tacoma Link to the Tacoma Community College. Daily ridership is estimated at approximately 525,000, and there would be 35 new stations. Other highlights are extended service on Sounder South. That improves people's access to Renton because they can take Sounder from the south to Tukwila and then transfer to a bus, or some people use van pools to access their destinations in Renton. In addition, we're looking at bus operation on some freeway shoulders to speed up operations, and we're looking at access improvements to Link and Sounder stations. And then, as I was mentioning, 405 will have BRT, and then we're also looking at BRT, bus rapid transit, on SR 522 that connects the cities at the north end of the lake. So this just talks about a concept that we're looking at is an early delivery of some components, and that would be the bus on shoulder operation that I mentioned. And then we're looking at ways to deliver the parking earlier than, I mean, we're looking at 2019 to 2024, but we're also looking at, are there ways to deliver those projects a little earlier? Here are some dates for all the light rail extensions, and if you need more information, if you like more information, it's on our website at soundtransit3.org if you want to delve into all the details of all the projects. Also, we have a survey online that people can fill out at home on their home computer and tell us what their comments on about are about ST3. And then just to wrap up, there are environmental studies, like I mentioned, the environmental study from Bellevue to Kirkland to Bothell, and then there are some high-capacity transit corridor studies, one across the northern half of the lake, looking at their needs for additional capacity across 520 or possibly the middle of the lake or around the north end of the lake, and then Everett to Everett Community College and commuter rail to Ording. And the cost of the plan is estimated at $200 per adult, or an average of $17 a month. And then we're having a series of open houses throughout the five sub areas to get people's comment, but you can also comment online, fill out the survey, talk to your council members, talk to your board members. And then the board will be identifying a final plan in June to take to the voters in November. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions or comments from council?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Corman.
Yeah, I'd just like to say that we did review the same presentation in Committee of the Whole, and many of the council members did have lots of lively questions and concerns they expressed at the time. I guess if it's okay, maybe we could have council summarize, if any members want to summarize any of those concerns.
Sure.
I would just encourage everyone to take the survey.
Is there anybody else that wanted to make any comments?
I could go on to the presentation I discussed. One of the concerns I know other council members shared, and I have it too, is that there's a lot of light rail in this plan. Renton residents have paid a lot for Sound Move and Sound Transit too, and there was this sort of overall feeling that we're just not getting equivalent value back. Lots of difficulty getting access to the system as it is. We've seen lots of new services go into other cities, new parking garages, new infrastructure, new everything, and so far, City of Renton's really come up pretty dry in terms of what we've gotten. So if there was a Sound Transit 3 that went forward and it had BRT, it was of if that was in fact going to be Renton's available transit for the next 25 years, I'd said that I wanted to make sure that it was very much in keeping with that we had a common understanding of the BRT that was developed as part of a state-funded study of I-405 that I had participated in. And then I offered to bring in that material. And I guess it's putting the two representatives from Sound Transit on the spot to maybe try and reconcile what that presentation is with what they know BRT is in this proposal. But ultimately, we should just make sure we're all on the same page, I think. So to just expand on that a little bit more, about 16 years ago, the state was looking at the next growth for I-405, and they'd commissioned three committees, a citizens committee, a staff expert committee, and then a executive committee that consisted of local officials up and down the corridor, as well as state and county officials. And I had participated as Renton's representative on that executive committee. The plan that we had come up with at the time was two new general purpose lanes, both directions on I-405, with sort of a little caveat that one of the two general purpose lanes could be as an alternative, it could be a toll lane, and be married to the existing HOV lane and have, why can I not think of what we call it, congestion pricing, similar to what's going on in the north end on 405. However, I will say that that at the time, the plan looked better in my mind because the there was not the whole thing about kicking out the two-person carpools was not part of that plan. At the time, it was presented to us as the toll lane would be an option. Two-person carpools could still use those lanes, as well as there was no need to have a transponder if you were going to use those lanes as a carpool. a lot of those elements have made it really, really difficult, and there's a whole lot of pushback now, as everybody knows, on the way that that is going forward, which is relevant because I think it puts into question exactly what's going to happen in the South End. And unfortunately, that's a sort of a foundational element for BRT. So I'd say, you know, the BRT proposal is still a little bit in doubt because of the fact that the state can't seem to get its arms around how to do the implementation of the toll lane. So, but with that, can somebody show what the BRT, we had a presentation on that. It's about a 10-year-old presentation, but it still is relevant now as when the committees approved it. And just to clarify again, this was endorsed. The state was co-chaired this session, came up with this concept, and so this is what the state of Washington really has on record is what the BRT should look like. Okay, and I'll try and make this really brief, but when we talk BRT, we're talking bus rapid transit, and it's not just any buses. If we could go to the next page. Whoops, some technical difficulties. Okay, so so in some ways, bus rapid transit vehicles look similar to the, you know, maybe the metros or Sound Transit's biggest articulated buses, but they would consistently have a low floor design, a lot of passenger amenities, a lot of capacity, carrying up to 100 people each, and operational enhancements. So you can't just put any bus on the route and call it bus rapid transit. If we go to the next page. So we've got standard and articulated buses. The articulated have a seated capacity of 64 and a standing capacity of 48, so more than 100. Go to the next page, please. Okay, so here's where the BRT starts differing significantly from just sort of the standard bus that does a milk run through your neighborhood and picks people up on every, you know, every arterial. The bus rapid transit relies on buses that have very careful docking. They dock in a station where the platform of the station is level with the floor of the bus, have multiple doors that open at the same time. People can basically rush onto the bus. There's little risk of tripping. There's no stairs. People that are mobility challenged don't have any difficulties getting onto the bus. And so essentially the whole idea is just like, you know, just like a race car making a pit stop. You want the bus to stop quickly, as many people to get in as possible, up to 100, and then to take off again all in, you know, like a minute. Similar to what we see when we have trains. And part of that is, well, I think the next page shows it. Go ahead. If you can go to the next page. So we know when the trains are coming in, so people are ready for them, or when the buses are coming in, excuse me, the same kind of reader boards you'd see at train stations. In the lower right, we're basically showing where you would pay to board the bus. So essentially, everybody that's on that platform has either prepaid or else there's a system in place where they're going to actually pay, you know, using a credit card or something while they're on the bus, or show their ORCA card or whatever. But the key is the driver's not going to mess with everybody's cards and tokens as people board, because you're not going to get 100 people on quickly and still compete with the train that way. So so you've streamlined the fare collection. And if we could go on. Then the buses would have other features. They'd have queue jump capabilities. The the pavement would basically accommodate them and give them their own right-of-way wherever possible. Next page, please. Again, the way that it was presented to us is they could even have transit signal priority, so that a little bit more like a train, they'd be able to, you know, keep moving quickly. If we could go on. Okay, we'll talk a little bit about stations. Stations would basically look a lot like train stations. If we go to the next page. Essentially, the BRT stations would be connected to suitable parking facilities. Again, just like when you do a train station, it's not effective unless you have a lot of parking available. Next page, please. A typical layout, plan view of the park and ride. This was a good picture, and I think this is representative of the what was really talked about and offered on I-405, which is that one side or the other of the freeway, you'd have a large parking facility, a bridge that goes over the freeway that then connects to the BRT stations on both sides, with elevators for access for people that need them. And that one of the elements is that there's limited stops, so that you're not going to have this bus go into a neighborhood and get bogged down. So go on to the next page. Okay, that's the same view, just an aerial view. And then if we could go on, okay, go to the next one. Okay, this was a potential alignment of BRT showing, and this again was coming out of the committee about 10 years ago. It actually had some pretty good coverage in the Renton area for this BRT service that was offered at the time. We were, when it was discussed, the state said the intent would be to get speeds up to so they could maintain speeds of, you know, at least like 45 or 50 miles an hour on I-405 using a combination of two lanes, you know, the existing HOV lane plus a new lane, and the two of them would be paired up as sort of an HOV hot lane combo, and that the bus could maintain, 45, 50 miles an hour, could go 65 when there wasn't bad traffic. And then they'd use all the, they'd try and keep them as much as possible on the 405 right of way. And then it would make connections with the light rail. So, I guess I feel like if this BRT actually went into place, and I noticed as I look at this picture, there was a few Renton stations, and Mr. Mayor, I know that now there's discussion about sort of trimming back some of those stations. Those stations where you have a big park and ride next to the freeway and a bridge over the freeway and the elevators and things, I think you were telling me cost $100 million each, so they may not want to put three in Renton like it shows here. But the key is it would have to make lightning-fast speeds and lightning-fast connections with the access to Bellevue, Redmond, and Seattle, and then I think happen early in the life of Sound Transit 3, or else residents of Renton are going to really feel left out in the cold for a long time. So that's what I have. I don't know if that's what the Sound Transit 3 board is considering. I've heard people talk about bus rapid transit and then end up with just ordinary buses that, you know, don't look any faster, they're different. So I don't know what this would
be. We've teamed up with Bellevue, Kirkland, and other cities to make sure that we're all on the same page when we're talking about BRT. So
very good. And all of those cities that you mentioned were represented on the 405 committee, so
right.
They should all have the same right. Materials. Good.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Corman. Yep. Any other questions for our Sound Transit folks? Well, thank you very much for coming tonight. We really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to administrative report, Mr. Covington.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. Probably the main item I'd like to just make everyone aware of is that, as council knows, we have looked for ways to better enforce abandoned shopping carts. We've worked for several years with business owners and the community to try to see if we can't figure out a way to reduce the abandoned carts in the community, which end up being an eyesore and cost money for disposal. So we have rolled out a new effort. It's called Corral the Carts. We are going to dedicate one day a week members of our staff to collect abandoned shopping carts. Once they're collected, business owners have an opportunity to come and reclaim those carts and pay a fee. We are working with the business owners to let them know when we will be collecting those carts, so that if they would like not to have to pay a fee, they can go out a day ahead of us and collect the carts on their own. That would be our preference, that the business owners actually take responsibility. We also obviously want to encourage our residents, remind them that shopping carts are not theirs to take. They actually do belong to the stores, and they're to be used in the place of business. So this is kind of a combination. We are working this effort. I want to encourage the public, if you do see an abandoned cart, please give us a call at 425-430-7400 to report the location. Or you can email us you know what, call us. You'll never remember the email address. we'll give it to you. Give us a call. We'll then put that on the list and see if this can work towards reducing the number of carts. In addition, just with this great weather this week, we're going to be out in a number of locations working on streets, so we'd encourage the public to watch for those signs for partial closures, and particularly for any signal people in the street, use caution and patience. That's all, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Covington. Next item is audience comment. Have a couple people signed up to address the council. When I call your name, please come to the podium. Give your name and city of residence for the record, and you have 5 minutes. There is a timer next to the city clerk. Alan Pence. Sorry about that.
I have that happen a lot. Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen of the council, I appreciate letting me come and speak with you tonight. I have a bit of a quandary. The utilities division of the city of Renton has been implemented since 2009. The fees for stormwater collections, and over the past 7 years, when you first started it out, it was about $24 a month. And as of this last payment, it's now up to $41.19 per month for stormwater fees. But per RCW 90.03.500, stormwater control facilities, I bring this to your attention. The legislature finds that increasing the stormwater or stormwater acclimation on or flow over real property beyond which that is naturally occurs on the real property may cause severe damage to the real property and limit the gainful use or enjoyment of the real property, resulting in a tort, nuisance, or taking. The damage can arise from activities increasing to the point or non-point flow of surface water or stormwater over the real property, or altering or interrupting the natural drainage from the said real property. And according to RCW 90.03.520, Section 2, stormwater control facility means any facility, improvement, development, property, or interest therein made, constructed, or acquired for the purpose of controlling or protecting life or property from any storm, waste, flood, or surplus waters. So the question that I have here is, we have no storm drains, no sidewalks, no sewer on our roads. And the Southeast 7th Street is also in the same predicament. No stormwater, no sewer, no sidewalks. So how can we be charged for stormwater fees when we don't have any way to collect the stormwater? So my question is, A, you have a new project going right next door to us that is bringing in 31 homes. They brought in sewer, they brought in stormwater drains, and we are butted right next to them. But yet, we have all of this water that comes right down our roads, and I'm at the bottom of the hill, and guess where it ends up? Right at the bottom of my hill, right in my house. So my question is to you, A, do you please rescind all of the funds that you've collected over the last 8 years? Or B, Do you propose to be able to bring stormwater drainage to the bottom of my property down our road and the other road and tie it into the project that is going on right next door? So that's the question that I have for you, and I would really appreciate some input from you because I don't know where else to turn.
Absolutely. We'll be happy to do that. I guess Greg Zimmerman can help. If we could, you could provide him with your contact information.
It's already on the slip of paper.
We'll look at the address and check that out.
Okay.
Okay, and see what we can do. See what we can do. Yes, Mr. Krim.
Can I just ask also, you live in a regular home?
Yes.
Because the rate you quoted seemed awfully high. I was surprised.
I have the bill right here, sir, if you'd like to see it.
And I'm glad you brought that to our attention. And I know Mr. Zimmerman will take interest in that. I'm confused as to why the fee was that high, but okay.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate your time.
You bet. Thank you. Next is Thomas Martin.
Good evening, Mayor Law, Councilman Prince, and everybody else. I'm Tom Martin. I live here in Renton. I wanted to address a concern of mine. Was there's been a lot of smoking down at the transit center, and smoking of tobacco is bad enough, but then smoking of marijuana, that puts me in jeopardy at my work, because if I go to work smelling like grass, I could be subject to urinalysis. I work at the SeaTac Airport, and it came to my attention, there was another lady that had a concern about this, is that she was working with troubled personnel that were trying to keep themselves clean, but if she goes in to work with them, she's a social worker or some kind of social level, and they smell the marijuana or the smoke and stuff like that, these people might have to have a little bit of a relapse on their services. So I need to be in touch with the Metro and help them about getting signage down at the transit center for no smoking. And then I was hoping maybe for some enforcement on something like this. I mean, I'm not sure as to what we could do.
Well, we do have an ordinance on which we can enforce. So can you tell me what time of day you normally see that?
I leave for work. I get there just about 9 o'clock.
Okay. Okay, we will look into that.
Let's see. That's about all I got. Thank you very much.
Okay, you bet. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to the consent agenda. There are four items for council consideration. Are there any items a council member would like to pull for discussion?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. Corman.
I move approval of the consent agenda as published.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Corman, seconded by Mr. Pavone, that council approve the consent agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Moving on to unfinished business, Mr. Corman.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I have one committee of the whole report to present.
Committee of the whole committee report, April 18th, 2016, solid waste collection contract. The committee of the whole recommends concurrence in the staff recommendation to approve the solid waste contract with Republic Services. The committee also recommends concurrence in the staff recommendation to prepare an ordinance for first reading. This is signed by the council president.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Corman.
I move the council concur in the committee report.
Second.
So moved by Mr. Corman, seconded by Mr. Pavone, the council concur with the committee of the whole report. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. I want to just thank our staff, public works staff, and especially Linda Knight, who's been working really hard on this contract and having a lot of cooperation with Republic. So thank you very much, Linda. Okay, Mr. Prince.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. The Planning and Development Committee has a committee report.
Hey, Planning and Development Committee report. City Center Community Plan Advisory Board recommendations. In order to ensure the City Center Community Plan is implemented and successful, the city created the City Center Community Plan Advisory Board. The board is tasked with making recommendations regarding which strategies of the plan should be prioritized for inclusion in departmental work programs. The Planning and Development Committee has reviewed the recommendations of the board and directs staff to initiate work for the following strategies. Work to implement recommendation from the Arts and Culture Master Plan to expand the presence of art activities and art facilities in the city center. Create a building improvement program for buildings within the city center. Continue to improve incentives to encourage investment and employment in the city center. Determine necessary utilities and infrastructure to support the city center. Continue to support community events in downtown. Conduct a detailed design study for Park Avenue North and implement the city's trail and bicycle master plan. This is signed by the committee chair and members.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the council concur with the Planning and Development Committee report.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McGirvin, that council concur with the Planning and Development Committee report. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Okay, Ms. Witchy.
No unfinished business, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, Mr. McGirvin.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, the Utilities Committee has a committee report.
Utilities Committee report. Interlocal agreement for the Cedar River Section 205 flood control project. The Utilities Committee recommends concurrence in the staff recommendation to execute the interlocal agreement between King County Department of Natural Resources and Parks, Water, and Land Resources Division and the City of Renton for maintenance of the Cedar River Section 205 flood control project. The city budget will be adjusted to include this grant revenue in the next budget adjustment ordinance. The committee further recommends that the resolution regarding this matter be adopted as presented. This is signed by the committee chair and members.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. McGirvin.
I move that the council concur with the recommendation of the Utilities Committee.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. McGirvin, seconded by Mr. Corman, that council concur with the Utilities Committee report. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Okay, Ms. Perez.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I have a Transportation Committee has a committee report.
Okay, Transportation Aviation Committee report. Temporary road closure of North 3rd Street at Logan Avenue North. The Transportation Aviation Committee recommends concurrence in the staff recommendation to approve the temporary road closure of North 3rd Street at Logan Avenue North for up to 4 continuous weeks in or around May 2016 and adopt a resolution authorizing this closure to accommodate construction of this segment required for the project. This is signed by the committee chair and vice chair.
I move that the council concur with the committee report.
Second.
Been moved by Ms. Perez, seconded by Ms. Witchy, that council concur with the Transportation Committee report. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. And so for the public's information, this is a major part of our Logan Street reconstruction and requires the closure in order for us to finish that work. Okay, Mr. Pavone.
No unfinished business, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Moving on to resolutions and ordinances, we have 3 resolutions and a ton of ordinances.
Wow.
The first resolution is regarding the Cedar River Section 205 agreement. A resolution of the City of Renton, Washington, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to enter into an interlocal agreement with King County regarding the Cedar River Section 205 Flood Hazard Reduction Project Flood Wall Joint Sealant Replacement and Vegetation Management.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. McGirvin.
I move that the resolution be adopted as read.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. McGirvin, seconded by Mr. Corman, that this resolution be adopted as read. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
The next resolution is regarding the closure, the temporary road closure. A resolution of the City of Renton, Washington, authorizing the temporary closure of North 3rd Street at Logan Avenue North for up to a 4-week period in or around May 2016 for the Logan Avenue North project.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Ms. Perez.
I move the resolution be adopted as read.
Second.
It's been moved by Ms. Perez, seconded by Ms. Witchy, that this resolution be adopted as read. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
The final resolution is part of the Docket 11. It's D-124. A resolution of the City of Renton, Washington, repealing resolution numbers 1450, 2073 and 2075 as the plans adopted thereunder have been superseded or are no longer applicable.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move that the council adopt the resolution as read.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this resolution be adopted as read. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You guys have it.
Okay, the following ordinances are for first reading. The first ordinance is Docket 11, number D-116. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending sections 4260, 4280, 42110, and 42115 of Chapter 2, Zoning Districts, Uses and Standards, Section 49250 of Chapter 9, Permits Specific, and Sections 41120 and 411230 of Chapter 11, Definitions of Title 4, Development Regulations of City Code, by amending residential building height regulations, amending the definition of building height, and adding definitions for wall plate and wall plate height.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it.
The next ordinance is regarding Docket 117. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending sections 42110 and 42120 of Chapter 2, Zoning Districts, Uses and Standards, Section 4965 of Chapter 9, Permits Specific, and Section 41110, Definitions of Title 4 Development Regulations of the City Code, by amending density bonus regulations and amending the definition of affordable housing.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
The next ordinance is Docket 119. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending Section 4960 of Chapter 9, Permits Specific of Title 4 Development Regulations of City Code, amending the regulations relating to payment of a fee in lieu of frontage improvements.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
And the next ordinance is Docket 120. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending sections 4770 and 4780 of Chapter 7, Subdivision Regulations, and Section 4890 of Chapter 8, Permits, General and Appeals of Title 4, Development Regulations of City Code, adding regulations requiring a public neighborhood meeting for subdivisions and planned urban developments, and amending the regulations regarding public notice requirements.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
And the next ordinance is Docket D-122, an ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending sections 41160 and 41190 of Chapter 1, Administration and Enforcement of Title 4, Development Regulations of City Code, by combining the regulations for all impact fees into one section.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Halfway there, Jason.
All right. The next ordinance is Docket 123. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending Section 42120 of Chapter 2, Zoning Districts, Uses and Standards of Title 4 Development Regulations of the City Code, revising setbacks in commercial and mixed-use zones.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I move that the ordinance be placed on second final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
Been moved by Mr. Prince and seconded by Mr. Corman. This ordinance be placed in second and final reading at the next council meeting. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
And the next ordinance is Docket 124A. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, repealing ordinance number 4970 as the South Renton Neighborhood Plan adopted thereunder has been superseded.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
And the next item is docket 124B, an ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending section 4430 of chapter 4, citywide property development standards of title 4 development regulations of city code by deleting outdated plans adopted by reference and adopting new plans by reference.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Yeah, the final docket ordinance is number 126, an ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, amending sections 4260 and 42110 of Chapter 2 Zoning Districts, Uses and Standards, 4440, 4470, 4480, 44100, and 44140 of Chapter 4 Citywide Property Development Standards, 4690 of Chapter 6 Street and Utility Standards, 48120 of Chapter 8 Permits, General and Appeals, 4960 of Chapter 9 Permits Specific, and 411250 of Chapter 11 Definitions of Title 4 Development Regulations of City Code, correcting and revising code pursuant to the Community and Economic Development Department's administrative code interpretations.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
I move that the ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it.
Okay, the final ordinance is regarding a street vacation request. An ordinance of the City of Renton, Washington, vacating a portion of right-of-way in the vicinity of Sunset Lane Northeast, Harrington Avenue Northeast, and Northeast 10th Street. Petition VAC 16001.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Mr. Prince.
Move that the ordinance be placed in second and final reading the next council meeting.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. McIrvin, that this ordinance be placed on second and final reading at the next council meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, Jason. Moving on to new business, Mr. Corman.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor. Got hypnotized by all
all those ordinances.
All right. You were busy.
Yes. We don't need to meet the rest of the year.
We get to do it again next week.
I know. Great.
Can't wait.
I'm thinking I chaired that committee last year, and I guess I didn't get anything done. You guys are really playing catch up.
We're doing all this.
Changing them all.
Okay, so I just have a committee of the whole meeting to announce for April 25th. That's a Monday, 5:30 p.m. And committee of the whole in the conferencing center. Two items on that agenda. The first is capital budget projects update, and the second is council referral processes.
Okay. Did you want to expand that at all?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, actually, I wanted to expand it a little bit. Thank you for reminding me. So basically, I'd actually like to make the second item more a discussion about council policies, and as follow-up to the offsite. We talked about some things we might change, and so I'd like to just formalize that a little bit. So council policy discussion.
Okay.
Okay.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Prince.
Oh, after all that, I don't have any committee meetings to announce.
You better not. Ms. Witchy.
No new business, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Mr. McIrvin.
No new business, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Ms. Perez.
No new business, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Mr. Pavone, I know you've got some.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'm reading for two committees. The first one is April 25th, Monday at 3 p.m. The Public Safety Committee will meet, and we have three items. The first is amending RMC 10-10-3, vehicles blocking mailboxes. Number two is increased bonus pay and benefits for lateral hires in PD. Number three is emerging issues in public safety. And then also on Monday, April 25th at 4 o'clock, the Finance Committee will be meeting, and we have six items. The first is landscape maintenance contract agreement. The second is interlocal agreements to accept FINI grant funding. The third is senior planner hire at Step E and temporary double fill. Four is Sunset Neighborhood Park grant applications and funding. Number five is vouchers. And number six is emerging issues and revenue streams. That is all, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to audience comment, was anybody who wanted to address the council?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. Corman.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify. So I looked at next week's Committee of the Whole meeting. It's going to be in the conferencing center. So I just wanted the council members and the public to know that one of the items, the reason I'm expanding it so it's not just a referral process, I actually wanted to have a discussion about the second audience comment we have a and I'll give you the preview. So we have a policy that's been in place for probably 20 years or something where and I was just looking at the way the agenda is written today. It doesn't have all the words it usually says, but typically the policy is we give everybody 5 minutes. We had a lively discussion a year or two ago about whether we should reduce that to 3 minutes, and I think we decided let's keep it at five, and so we've kept it at five, and I think five is working fine. But we also had said in this policy statement that we would cut it off at 30 minutes and then move on to the rest of our agenda. And then the second audience comment was actually a mechanism that we would catch anybody that didn't get a chance to speak the first time. And I actually remember, I don't know if I was on council at the time, but I was in the council chambers a lot when this policy had gotten in place. In fact, it was its history was that it started when there was a couple of different big planned unit developments going into town. There were a lot of people, a lot of consternation, a lot of people that would come and speak. And basically, I think the council was feeling like the meeting would get almost filibustered with this audience comment that would go on 2 hours. And staff would need to leave, and then they couldn't get to the business. So they created this mechanism that it would be 30 minutes of speaking. If everybody used their 5 minutes, that meant six people could go, and then everybody else would have to wait their turn to the end of the meeting. What has happened is it's kind of a confusing explanation when people have come in and seen that printed on the agenda. I noticed it's not printed on there tonight about the 30 minutes max. But then the mayor's been very gracious, and we've all gone along that when the audience comment's gone 40 minutes, we've just let people go because it seems kind of rude to just say we're cutting it off now and going on. And so what I was going to discuss next week, just get your candid feedback. Yeah, I mean, you could say anything you want now, but the candid feedback for next week would be the proposal would be we would just go to a simple system where everybody gets 5 minutes and it just takes as long as it takes at audience comment, and then we would just go on with the rest of the meeting. And the one change would be if somebody wanted to come up at the end and had a positive thing to say or a criticism of something we said or clarification and they wanted it on the record, they'd have to follow up with an email instead of just telling us at the mic. Or they could, if it was just they wanted a clarification, they could catch us privately after the meeting. But that's what I wanted to talk about.
So. And the other thing is, if there was a particular reason where we knew we were going to have a ton of people, the council on any given week can change the schedule of the agenda.
Yeah.
So that can always be altered to meet your needs. So.
Sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So, no action on that. We'll just discuss it next week. So
I need a motion to adjourn.
Oh, move to adjourn.
Second.
Mm-hmm. The move by Mr. Prince, seconded by Mr. Corman, that we adjourn. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposing? Okay, we're adjourned.